So there's an interlink of cancer and regeneration. How? So you can see there's a regeneration. So we saw that in regeneration, the amputated site, the cells goes into undifferentiated state. That means the cell is in stem cell. So now this stem cell has to produce the lost part. So for that, they'll do a cell division. So for that cell division, there will be a proto-oncogenes activation. Okay? So there will be a proto-oncogenes activation. And to stop that cell division, there will be tumor suppressor gene activation. But if there's a problem in proto-oncogenes activation or tumor suppressor gene activation, due to mutation, then because of that mutation, there will be a cancerous growth. So that's the reason we are using earthworm as a model for the cancer biology. So it becomes easy for us to develop a cancer in it, because it's a very easy process to understand. So that's the reason we are using earthworm as a model system. So to achieve these, we have some objectives. So our immediate objective was, again, if we are using earthworms, we need to maintain and culture our earthworms properly so that while taking any experiment or doing any experiment, we don't have problem of the maintenance. Then the second thing is to give lesion to dorsal and ventral side, which we'll explain ahead. Then the short-term objective is to understand how many times the ventral nerve cord will regenerate, how much times it will require. And the main part will be inducing HDAC or introducing HDAC to the earthworm for these cancer formation. So these are our short-term objectives. And the long-term objective, as I said, developing earthworm as a model system for cancer biology. Now we explained something called as we'll be inducing HDAC. So exactly how it works, this is the mechanism. Like, it's called histone modification. So how this histone modification takes place normally in cell. So you can see the ball kind of structure is a histone, and the bind kind of structure is a DNA. So histone has a positive charge and DNA has a negative charge. So these positive and negative has an interaction, it get attached and go into a winding state. But now, if a cell or a gene wants to express, DNA cannot express its gene in a winding state, because RNA polymerase has to bind to that gene expression. So for that, these histone and the DNA has to go into unwinding state. So for that, what comes is HAT. What is HAT? Histone acetylase transferase. It's an enzyme which is produced by another gene. So this enzyme comes and bind to the histone. Okay. So what it actually does is add acetyl group. Acetyl group has a negative charge. So it will immediately change the state, like histone's charge. Like, it will convert into a negative histone. And what will happen? Histone will come aside and the DNA will be unwind. So if it will be an unwinding state, now RNA polymerase can bind and it will give you the gene expression, whatever you want. Suppose I want a cell division. So cell division gene is going to express in an unwinding state. But we cannot keep this DNA open always. So there need to be a guy who will come to the histone and make it into a winding state. Because if it will be an unwinding state, again it will cause a tumor to your body. So to avoid that, there's a HDAC. HDAC is histone deacetylase. It is again an enzyme produced by another gene. So these HDAC comes and binds to the histone. Now these HDAC removes the acetyl group and make it positive. Okay. Once it is positive, now the DNA can bind. And it will again go to its winding state, and now the gene expression has been stopped. But what we are going to do is, we'll stop this HDAC. Like, we have a molecule called HDAC inhibitor. Inhibitor means that will inhibit the HDAC activity. So these HDAC inhibitor will go and bind to this HDAC enzyme. So what will happen is, it will inhibit the activity and it will remove the HDAC from that histone and DNA winding condition. So what will happen? Again, the histone will go into a negative, positive, negative charge, and the DNA will be in the the DNA will also be in the negative charge and it will be unwind. So what will happen? The gene will always expressed. It will always express. And taking this as a modification, so our hypothesis is if we introduce this HDAC inhibitor to our earthworm at the site of amputation, then there will be a tumor formation because of the gene expression is always going to be open. So that's the reason we are introducing HDAC inhibitor so that it will inhibit the HDAC activity. So this is our hypothesis. This is our main, like our main motto towards our project. So design of our experiment.
So to achieve the goal, there must be a design of experiment. So in our design, we took the total number 12 earthworms, from which four was a dorsal lesion earthworm, 4 for ventral, and 4 for the control, that is unlesioned earthworm. And lesion will be given from the scletellum from clitellum between 10th and 11th segment. And RER assay will be done before the lesion and after the lesion. And we choose that after lesion, we will do RER in the interval of 3-3 hours, so we can find out the exact regeneration time of the ventral nerve cord. Okay. And basically, RER is a rapid escape response. So, what is the protocol for RER assay? So, in the first test tube, we will fill the distill water, 1 ml of distill water, and the second test tube, we will fill the 1 ml of NaCl solution, which is 200 millimolar. And special care must be taken here is the solution must be fill in the test tube without touching the walls of the test tube. And second is to remove the earthworm from the cup cultures and with the brush and swirl earthworm in the distill water so we can remove out the feces or the impurities on the earthworm. And next step is introduce earthworm in a distill water and start the timer for 2 minutes. And again, remove the earthworm from the distill water test tube after the 2 minutes and dab the earthworm on the tissue paper so extra water will be absorbed by the tissue paper. And pick up the earthworm and introduce into the another test tube which have the 200 millimolar NaCl solution and start the timer for 2 minutes. And if after 2 minutes, remove the earthworm from the NaCl solution and introduce into the distilled water wash for the 2 times. Okay, so the NaCl solution from the earthworm will be removed. So protocol for 200 millimolar NaCl solution. To make 200 millimolar NaCl solution, we'll make first stock for the 1 molar of NaCl solution. Like for the 1 molar of NaCl solution, we'll add 58.4 gram of NaCl into the 1,000 liter of distilled water. So it will be the 1 molar of NaCl solution. And after that, remove the 20 ml of the NaCl solution from the 1 molar of NaCl solution and keep it in a measuring cylinder and fill up to the 100 ml of mark with the distilled water, so it will be the 200 millimolar solution. Okay, so at the starting we have some of the problems with the RER. So this is the journey how we standardize our RER assay. For the preparation of 200 millimolar solution, we actually serial diluted the 1 molar of NaCl solution 5 times, like 20 ml in 80 ml distilled water, again 20 ml in 80 ml of distilled water. So goes on in the 5 times. So right now we are not doing this. We are using standard protocol for the 200 millimolar. And the cleaning of test tube was the problem, we do not wipe this wipe the test tube before introducing the earthworm or the introducing solution. And the amount of solution in the test tube was we put the 3 ml of solution in the test tube, in this 3 ml of distilled water, 3 ml of NaCl, and later we like in later we added after the standardization we add 1 ml of distilled water and 1 ml of NaCl, and next problem was the handling of solution. Like we used to pour the solution in the test tube like in a such a way that it will like attach to the wall of the test tube and all, and after that we standardize that the solution it will pour into in the test tube without touching the wall of the test tubes, and this is our the graph before the standardization after the standardization.
This is a graph before standardization, when we were used to do these mistakes. So what we expected was we'll get 100% result from NaCl. That means we expect earthworm should come out of the NaCl as it causes irritation to the earthworm. So every earthworm should come out of the NaCl solution. And in distilled water, as it doesn't contain any ions, it won't cause any irritation. So we expected that it won't come out of the distilled water. So this is our goof of one, the graph. So before standardizing, we got something result like this, that it was coming out of the distilled water. 25% of the earthworm was coming out of the distilled water, and something around 47% was coming out, were coming 41%. Out of the NaCl solution, where we expected 100%. So after standardization, we got the expected result, where distilled water, none of the earthworm came out of the distilled water, and the 100% earthworms came out of the NaCl solution.
Okay, so for so the
after that the standardization, we move to the further journey, that is protocol for lesion.
Yeah. Like in the earlier dilution, we diluted more the
So what we did is we made 1 molar solution properly, like adding 58.4 gram in 1000 ml. So that dilution was proper 1 molar solution. But while making 200 millimolar solution, the preparation or the protocol for making 200 millimolar solution is we need to take 20 ml of 1 molar solution in a measuring cylinder, and the remaining up to the mark 100 we need to add distilled water. So this solution is like 200 millimolar standard solution. Okay, so this is the protocol. What we did is we did that solution, like we made this 200 millimolar solution, but we were not known that it is 200 millimolar solution, and we did five times serial dilution of it. That means the protocol or the 200 millimolar solution was not exactly a 200 millimolar solution.
Like from the 200 millimolar, we extracted 20.
So the dilution, yeah, and the dilution changed. Yeah, so. So it's 5 times we diluted. So 200. So it's
220, 200.
1000 millimolar solution. So it's 1000 millimolar solution. We made 1000 millimolar concentration of solution.
1000? No.
So it was 800.
1000 millimolar will be what? 1 molar?
1000?
Yeah.
One molar, correct?
No, sorry.
You're doing dilution. You're diluting, I guess.
Yeah.
Okay.
That's okay. Yeah.
Maybe around 20 millimolar or something you did.
Yeah.
20
yeah.
or 50. 40.
Yeah. So this is the protocol for lesion. Take a petri plate, put a ice on it, and cover the ice with the tissue paper. Place a earthworm on the ice, and place the petri plate in the dissecting microscope. Take a ethanol and swipe the blade with the give the lesion where you want to give. And so these are the our lesion position. Like E1, E2, E3, E4 are for the ventral nerve cord lesion. So the position of clitellum is like if we take a mean, there will be the like 13 to 23 or 24. That will be the position of the clitellum. And lesion on the segment was like around, if we take the mean of the lesion of the on the segment of all the earthworm, it will be like 33 to around 33, 34. Okay. Lesion pattern.
Lesion made.
So many segments, no? Clitellum is only.
Clitellum is from.
Three segments, as far as I approximately remember.
Approximately, it's from 11 to 23.
Okay.
So we and always count. So that's the reason we have shown the position of clitellum, because we counted every earthworm's clitellum.
Clitellum position.
Okay. So then how was it made up to 30? I'm like, I'm asking. I don't know. Yeah. That's why.
How what is
how the cut was made?
So,
count. Did you count it from 1, 2, 3, 4, 2, 3,
yes.
30?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Gave a lesion. So we your took clitellum as a marker.
Okay.
Because
and
now
from the clitellum, at the 10th and 11th segment.
So between 10 and 11, there will be a cut. So if this is the 10th segment and this is the 11th segment.
Okay, yeah. Now I understand. So the clitellum is only to, specify as a
marker.
Fine. Thank you.
So we can easily see the lesion. Yeah. And for the, this is our data. The before lesion, all the earthworms came out of the initial solution that we expected. And no earthworm is escaped from the distal water. And there is a big goof up.
Then
so after aria, after the lesion, we expected the none of the earthworm come out the NaCl solution as well as the distill solution, distill water.
How many earthworms were, including how many earthworms?
12. Yeah.
So aria of 12.
Aria of 12 earthworms.
So here if you conclude this graph, so here we can see that the lesion was not given proper to the ventral nerve cord. So that's why the earthworm E1, E2, E3, E4, which was a ventral lesion, they come out of the NaCl solution. So that what we are not expecting there.
So that's this was our major goof up. So later we had a break, we took 1 month break, that was due to some problems. Then we took our earthworm cultures to our Elphiston College. So the problem there we faced is we started culturing it in filter paper. And later, after culturing it for, two, three days, we started facing problem while maintaining our earthworm. So they started dying in the filter paper. So that's the reason, after doing all these things, again our earthworm started dying, and now we don't have any aria results proper. So we have not actually rectified this goof up because of this. So right now, we are actually doing that thing to minimal this goof up of maintenance actually. So we started with that. Now
so the tackle to this condition, we made the new cup culture with the filter paper and put
the tissue paper.
With the tissue paper and put the one earthworm in each cup cultures,
and now
we're gathering the data of this, earthworm is dying or not.
So right now we have a proper results, they are now easily staying in tissue paper. That means the filter paper was the fault which we are using in the college. So now we are getting a maintenance.
Yeah.
Have you also seen that if you change the kind of or the company from where you are buying these papers? Does that also have an effect?
No, we never saw because
the survival of earthworms.
No.
We use normal tissue paper,
which we were provided from the
normal
college.
Normal means what? I'm if you have a standard, no, everything is normal that way. So which company and all, who should specify that, when you say filter paper, which company? Maybe if you change the company, it would not work or it would work, I don't know.
We'll find out.
And why do you think it is happening? Why do you think the paper change is making a difference? Any idea? Have you thought about it or what?
We thought we are using filter paper, so we use filter paper from where the lab assistant keeps. So there is a possibility that sometimes some chemicals might have been exposed to that filter paper, and that's the reason our earthworms have started dying. So thinking with that perspective, we used now, we have started using now tissue paper because it was easy, and now, and tissue paper is like we can have anywhere. So now we started with the tissue paper culture.
So has that helped you?
Yes.
Changing
now,
yeah,
at least now it has been like 6 days. So none of the earthworms has died.
6 days.
No.
Yeah.
So it's 6 days.
So you
think there is some problem with the So you think there is some problem with the filter paper? In the sense, earthworm will not be sustained in filter paper.
It
cannot eat filter paper and survive.
Or
that you think that your lab assistant's filter paper,
yes,
is at fault.
Yes.
So why don't you right now also have got a control, some other, you have tissue paper as a control and
filter paper cup with some other filter paper.
You think that the source of filter paper is the problem, not the filter paper by itself. Because otherwise what you are giving the message is that don't use filter paper, only tissue paper this fellow is, and he's a pure vegetarian or something or something, is it?
No.
Pure filter paper vegetarian, tissue paper vegetarian. So what's the message you are giving? Is it that you have casually done something, so the filter paper is not at fault?
The lab assistant skipping.
Because
be
you are talking about, the point is that you are talking about earthworm. Earthworm is most of the places, and they may be much more sturdy than what you are making out the story to be, a very delicate baby you had to take care of with only tissue paper. So do you agree with me that the problem may not be
the filter paper, but
do you sort out? Otherwise you are giving a very wrong message to people that only tissue paper, and then only a particular brand of tissue paper. Do you really agree with that?
No.
No.
So we'll now keep three, four cup cultures of filter paper with, make sure that the filter paper is kept in a very, we are getting a filter paper in a very proper source without, like, they are not exposed to any chemicals or something.
For how long were you able to culture it earlier?
Filter paper, we started culturing from 1st of July.
July.
This 1st of July.
How is the experience with others of filter paper or any other paper or Times of India?
Actually, no one is using it in a culture to maintain an organism as a filter paper. We are the one who are using the filter paper for the culturing of organism. So
how did you think of it then, if you are the first ones?
Yeah,
how
so
did,
we thought
did,
like,
the
yes, the thing was like earthworms need a cellulose. As earthworm needs a cellulose.
Okay.
For the feeding. So we give tissue paper as a source of cellulose.
Okay.
We thought that filter paper is also kind of cellulose.
Of course it is.
So that's the reason we gave them filter paper. And it is easily available in a college as a good source. Mm. So we used filter paper. But later we got this problems. Mm.
Now what you can also do is you can maybe check on both and then see which one is, because your study has just been started. It's not too long. It's almost a month or so. So maybe you need to observe some more and, you know.
Yes.
You could also try some different kinds, like, you know, some different company make and see if it actually matters. But I don't think it should, but you can at least try.
Okay.
And then maybe you could go into it as to what that has or doesn't.
I would suggest that you should culture it in Lok Satta or Times of India and Hindu. Really, I'm seriously talking about it, because
it's a source.
See, I think your strong point is that you are working on regeneration and cancer in an organism which is present anywhere. Yeah, throughout the country probably, except in the coastal, you know, very, you know, very near to the coast or something, but, you know, salt water or something. But otherwise it is so your strong point is that your model system is available everywhere, which will be very sturdy, and you are making it out that it's a very, very flimsy organism. That I think you should address this question and show that it can survive anything. You know, I'm seriously talking about, you should take the newspaper and do it, you know, culture it. Because you have a technique of culturing it, you know, you have your cup culture.
Yeah.
So do that, a few setups, you can do that with joining with other people. Who are the other, you are from Elphinstone College, you are first year, second year, third
second
year?
Year.
Second year students. So you, do you have any more people from Elphinstone College?
No.
And do you have any more people working in other centers across the country?
Yeah, we have Ranchi, Vaishnavi is working, Risala from Kochi.
So could you suggest to them and could you collaborate with them and see that, you know, this is not a very, very, very weak organism.
Yeah.
Hmm. You can culture anywhere and things like that. I think that's a very important thing to sort out.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah, anybody else? Okay, yeah, please. Continue.
Yeah, so after this, we have further plans. What we'll be going to do in next 6 months. So now the basic thing is like now we discuss the maintaining of cup cultures, which is a very crucial point to maintain. Then the second is to give an accurate lesion. If we can't give an accurate lesion, then we are not going to get any specific results. So that's the very crucial point again. Then the concentration of HDAC inhibitor and how to introduce that HDAC into a earthworm will be our second challenge. Which we will be developing a protocol so that anybody in this country can do that process. So we'll standardize that protocol. So and also we'll have to check that.
1 second, I have a doubt with your number two for the plan. Hasn't it ever been done? I mean, like, has no one ever done this? So that you have to standardize it, or has it been standardized earlier?
No.
Because it is always good to use someone else's work if it has been standardized, no?
So, like Moina people are also working on the concentration of HDAC inhibitor. So,
but they are working on
Different
Moina,
thing.
Yeah.
But their organism and the model is approximately same.
Manasvi, what I think she is suggesting it is, see, you are addressing the question of cancer with the use of HDAC inhibitor or something. That's what your strategy. Is it that your invention or somebody else must have addressed this question earlier? Or it's only that you are...
Yeah.
Have you done any reference to that? How do people address or enter into the question of cancer? Did they address it through HDAC inhibition?
So,
we haven't...
So, otherwise, it's not a very... You know, it's a sort of your... That's what she's asking. Is there anything that we are saying that you are the first persons to do it? Did you address this question? Did you look for any references?
So,
one, whether on the references with respect to HDAC inhibition in cancer, the other, with reference to any other way by which you can induce cancer in a regenerating organism,
like earthworm.
Yeah, any regenerating organism, not necessarily earthworm, any regenerating organism. Did people address this question of how easy is to a regenerating organism to give rise to cancer than a non-regenerating organism? So if you don't address that, otherwise it's not you know, you are saying something as if you got a dream and you are starting the experiment.
No, we started this idea, like, we just got a strike when the Moina people were talking about this. Like, there's a gene regulation and all. So
it is important that you should look for literature to see that whether others have been looking at it.
Yeah.
Whether somebody has tried it and this is not a very reasonable way of looking at going for addressing question. And so that's what the spirit of what she was asking, Seema was asking.
So
okay,
please.
We haven't came across, like.
Yeah.
It's not came across. Did you look for it? The point is that. So
I just wanted to address another question, because none of these things that you have been discussing on the messaging systems, instant messaging systems, none of these details, none of these questions you have been, and you have not been also collaborating with other groups. If you are addressing these sort of issues, that what you are doing and what your intentions are in instant messaging systems like WhatsApp and stuff like that, and inviting other people who are in earthworm model systems, using earthworm as a model system, to work with you, then, you know, you would get a lot of help in literature search and all that. Otherwise, you are saying that, you know, it will be difficult for you alone to do it. The whole idea of so many people working in from different parts of the country, and in fact we waited for this streaming to happen, and fortunately now we are getting feedback that people, in fact Ranji people, are watching it. Okay, so we are getting the feedback from. So it's so important that you should be responding to that, and you should be always corresponding daily, regularly, and inviting their help.
Yes.
Yeah? Okay. Everybody said. So this is for everybody else, because this is what the advantage that we have with Cube. Because collaboration is very easily possible, because people are working on the same system in different parts of the country. So you don't have to struggle hard in order to get everything. If you discuss every day, if you report every day, you will be getting a lot of help from others, and you can help others as well. Okay. Thank you.
Okay.
So this is our reference slide. Acknowledgement.
Can you just go back?
Any interesting reference you wanted to show us? Any important reference?
Yeah, the history.
It's a big list, and we are not impressed.
So, histone acetylation in chromatin structure and transcription, the whole phenomena of histone modification, we took this that paper as a reference.
Which paper?
So I have a suggestion.
Okay.
See, a paper can be identified by two, three very interesting things. One is important things. One is by the author. The second is by the group. The author may be a PhD student or a whatever student. You know, he may or she may work there and then go away. But there will be a permanent faculty, a person there. This is a first only single author. Probably that he or she will be the person who is the main. So you can identify a paper with that author. The other is that you can identify a paper with the lab in which it was done, or from which it was published. The third is the publication, the journal in which it is published. So you have a fantastic journal, Nature. You have a single author there, Michael Grunstein. So these are the most important thing that you should be saying, not that one big list that you give and nobody will be impressed. Unless if you say that, okay, Michael Grunstein is paper is addressing a question on this particular thing. Which particular thing?
Histone
is not the point.
Like histone deacetylation process, how it occurs.
But does it have anything to do with cancer? Do they address the question on cancer? Because yours is not an examination question on how histone deacetylation takes place or something. It's not an examination question. Your question is with reference to a particular area you are interested in, that is regeneration and
cancer.
So do you have a paper like that? So this is, we are discussing at length this for everybody else. Yeah, because there is no point in just giving a big list and saying that nobody will be impressed. You know, anybody can copy a list like that. But in that, you will have to say that, okay, this paper we are interested in. And you will have to also say that why this paper is interested. To me, when I was looking at it, it looks like it's a Nature paper. And it should be reasonably good, you know, unless, of course, somebody fakes it, like, you know. And then they will withdraw. You know, in Nature and all that, they will have to withdraw after some time. And it's a single author paper. And it's a 1997 paper. So 1997 is an old paper.
Yeah.
So unless it is very clearly related to your work, I think you should not quote that.
Okay.
Okay.
There are questions.
What kind of this HDAC inhibitor are you using? Which chemical are you using?
Valproic acid. We thought about valproic acid. It is easily available in medicinal shop. And it's cheap.
So we have to research on that.
Thank you.
Anybody else? I think you have something to ask.
And the acknowledgement.
Ajay, you said that you use filter paper and tissue paper for the cellulose for their nutrition or something. Have you gone further that you can use cellulose from any chemical sites or any other sites besides using filter paper or any tissue paper? Have you think about that?
What kind of chemical site? Like using
which chemical?
Using like lab, you get cellulose powders or anything about that thing. Have you think about that thing?
So if we'll use cellulose powder, so Atvam say it's a moist condition. How will you
provide that? You can provide some moist conditions also, na?
How?
By mixing it with any distilled water, or you can keep it in that thing.
But instead of doing all this process, it's easy to get tissue paper and do it.
But as you said that you were using like filter papers.
No.
It was used for filter papers are used in lab only. So it must be like best way using any tissue paper.
So
because tissue paper may also have some like contaminated also by any hands or coming from outside. So the filter paper may be or like that only. I'm saying about the cellulose thing.
Yeah, so the same goes through the cellulose also. So cellulose will be also handled by someone else in your lab. So it can also get contaminated.
But you are using the sterile distilled water, na? Or you can use in sterile conditions also.
Why sterile? Artom is not.
But you
sterile.
Need, you don't want to contaminate it, na? So you were telling.
Earthworms feed on cellulose, that's okay. But if you use a cellulose powder and you'll add a water, okay? Suppose if the water goes limit, like you put it in a very huge amount, and now the cup is with the water and it's draining, and you won't give a draining system because it will be a liquefied thing. So how your earthworm is going
first
to
of
roam?
All earthworm needs moist condition, not the weight. It's not the it's not like a fish.
Yeah, and
you know,
roam.
But you know that you can you can control that. No, I think he has a valid point in what he has
said.
But you are not countering his point. You are countering his point by saying that it will have to swim and all that. But you can control the amount of water that you are using. Is it not? He's saying that instead of tissue paper, why don't you use pure cellulose powder? Your argument is that then the water will be too much. But water adding, you can control how much water you have to add. But the problem I think in his argument is that he's thinking that it has to be a sterile condition. In order to have a sterile condition, I think what he says is right. But do you really need a sterile condition?
No.
So that's the argument you will have to give it back to him. Because, but not water addition is under your control. You can, I don't think any reason why you can't culture it in cellulose powder, with wet cellulose powder, moist cellulose powder, according to whatever moisture that it needs. Do you think that there's a problem?
So, if we'll use a sterile water, so earthworms also feed on some bacteria. So, if you'll give him a sterile...
No. Your argument was that, it will be floating and they will be dying in suffocation, whatever. But that is not the argument. Now, the question is, his other question is that he is thinking probably, I think he can correct it, you can correct me. He is thinking probably that it has to be in sterile condition. It will be better if it is in sterile condition. Do you think that it has to be in sterile condition?
No. Because we normally give normal tap water because the tap water contains some bacteria.
No,
question
we are asking is that, do you need sterile condition?
No.
Yes or no?
No.
Because earthworms feed on some bacteria which are present in the water, like tap water. So if you'll give him a sterile, so he won't able to feed on that bacteria, and the bacteria will provide him some proteins. He cannot totally depend on the cellulose.
So why didn't you keep it that same thing in the normal tap water only? Why did you use that distilled water?
So we are not using distilled water.
For the cup
culture. You told that your control test tubes has that distilled water. So that time, why didn't you use that tap water?
Yeah, okay. So that's an experiment, RER. So in that, we don't want any ions or anything present in
for the control. Yeah,
control.
Distilled water may.
So you can make another control of tap water also, na? To see that from both you are getting the same results or not.
Because tap water also may contain minerals or the
ions or some kind of
the chlorine ions also.
Traces. So.
So.
Yeah, the RER and.
So
answer in contrast to him. In rainy seasons, when there are heavy rains, earthworms come out of the soil because they cannot live in water now. So if we will add water instead of using filter papers, like tissue papers.
That will be a more complicated procedure, na, to add that cellulose pump.
But see, earthworm also stay in soil. So if the soil is, not that moist, it is not...
But they need...
It is okay.
But they need a surface, no? So tissue paper will provide water also and a surface to live. I thought it will dissolve in water.
You thought it will be a dissolved water.
So there's a question on YouTube now, just on the live. Someone is asking why you have to on the live. So they are asking. Someone is asking that. So he's asking that if you are cellulose, why not leaves?
We can give leaves.
So,
cellulose cannot be used because it is complex with lignin, so it is very difficult. Maybe it can be difficult for earthworm to extract it.
No, but again, we can also understand how does it naturally live, okay? Where does it live and what does it eat in the natural environment?
Yeah.
Let's say, so you can answer that, what it eats and how does it, what?
So it feeds on cellulose and the bacteria which are present in the. So the cellulose source is the plants
leaf
or something.
Decayed leaf.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So say that it feeds
decayed matter.
Cellulose, but it won't get. Nature.
It's on the pure.
Won't,
yeah.
It won't get that, cellulose as in pure cellulose.
Yeah.
Yes.
So from where is it going to get that? No.
So.
Cellulose is not available as such in in pure form as such in nature.
Ma'am,
so source of the cellulose it needs. Yeah.
Ma'am, they can get cellulose from decomposed plants.
So we can use that.
Bacteria also are also there in that
so
soil.
You want source of cellulose.
Yes.
That is what.
You're telling about the tap water, that control can be of tap water, but how can it be a control? Because every tap water, every time it changes.
Okay.
But then too, he said that you can mix it in tap water also, na?
But he was culturing in a tap water, not tap.
Okay. Cup culture stuff.
Yeah.
What they said, as much as I understood, was they took two different things, one with ionated water and one was deionized water. So they just wanted to test that earthworm can come out of the test tube or not. That was their major thing. Why did they need to clear it about that? Why did you took NaCl and distilled water only?
So again the same, distilled water we took it as
why
a...
Did you do this?
NaCl, main motto after lesioning on the ventral side, why did you took only NaCl solution and distilled water?
Yeah. Okay, so the thing is, we did RER before the giving lesion.
No, you should not use RER just like that. You can
rapid
say,
escape
what is RER?
So
okay.
What is this RER thing?
So RER is rapid.
The question is that, what doesn't understand what is RER that you are talking about?
So RER is rapid escape response. So it checks
why
the.
Why are you doing this? That's what her question is. Why are you doing this?
So we are doing this to we wanted to check whether the earthworm has a proper ventral nerve cord or not.
The
before
connection
giving
of the
lesion
nerve.
And after lesion will this the record before giving lesion will help us to clarify that the our earthworms which we. So we did this experiment before lesion because to show that the earthworms which we used had a proper ventral nerve cord. So if
or
we
the connection between the all segment and it
have a proper coordination. So if we will keep it, if we'll put it in the NaCl solution and we'll keep it for 2 minutes, so NaCl will cause irritations to their skin. So their respiration will be in a problem. So it will come out of the NaCl solution. That means that the ventral nerve cord is in a proper condition. So these earthworms which we will be using for giving lesion, so that will act as a like proof that our earthworms which we used is a proper.
Can you just go to the board and explain to us why, what is that you are doing?
Okay, these are the two test tubes in which distilled water and the NaCl.
So what we do is we take an earthworm. So what we do is we take an earthworm and put it inside the distilled water and allow it to stay for 2 minutes. So what we expect is it should not come out of the distilled water, because distilled water doesn't contain any ions. So it is mineral free, so it won't cause any problem to the earthworm.
So earthworm will be comfortable in that distilled water, and explain to me.
Earthworm come out of water, na? They cannot stay for a longer
there's
time.
There's a large amount of water. Like in rainy season, there's a huge amount of water. So okay. In
so
that condition,
you're taking minimum quantity of water.
1 ml, yeah. And we are allowing only to stay so for two minutes.
Okay.
So distilled water. And the rainwater is what? Rainwater is a normal water which has which will contain iron, minerals,
no, it
everything.
Is a pure form of water, na, which come. It is a pure form of water, na, after condensation.
So, pure form of
it's
water,
like
and it will go into the soil. And the soil will contain
ions.
Yeah, so the tap. Okay, so the rainwater will come and go into the soil. The soil will contain ions, which will cause irritation to the earthworms.
Yeah.
And it will come out.
Okay.
So what you are saying is that when the rainwater falls into the soil, the water will now be contaminated by or get dissolved by a lot of ions, lot of salt and ions. So that may be the one that is causing the fellows to come out.
Hmm.
So something like what you are doing here in NaCl.
Yes.
With NaCl, what you are doing is actually you are simulating a condition of the
rainwater.
Actually, I wanted to ask, like, rather than ions and all that, do earthworms come out because of the osmotic pressure also?
Yes.
Yeah, that was
if there's an excess amount of water, so they respire through skin. So if there's an excess amount of water, the water will start going into the skin and there will be osmotic pressure problem and the earthworm is going to die.
So that I guess the filter paper thing, I guess the earthworms were dying because that, I guess there was more absorption of water, like that can also be a cause, na? Rather than that chemical one, because filter paper absorbs more water. So earthworm.
So we are taking that in consideration, like we do not over moist the tissue paper or not.
Or filter paper. So
okay.
Yeah, but that can be
but
the point.
But that can be a point.
Yeah.
Like
yeah.
The point.
Yeah, accepted.
This? So, so it doesn't escape.
Everybody agrees that the distilled water is not escaping.
Whatever she has told, according to that, they should not get out. Like, if you maintain everything, whatever she has told, like the water content is maintained and all.
You are talking about this distilled water. Why don't you, honestly, explain that
distilled water? Yeah. So, this test tube contained 1 ml of distilled water.
The volume is 1 ml. Yeah.
So, we put earthworm into the distilled water and allow it to stay for 2 minutes. And we expect that it won't escape from the distilled water. That means it won't come out of the distilled water.
So the time limit is 2 minutes.
But after 2 minutes or after some hours, it will come out, right?
Yeah.
Huh.
Yeah.
So the earthworm is fully submerged in this?
Yes, it is
yes,
fully
sir.
submerged.
It's a 13 ml test tube. Test tube.
I mean like what? 20 ml, the normal 20 ml.
Yeah, normal one.
So you have to specify all that. How much is 1 ml in that 20 ml tube? Whether the earthworm is fully submerged in that?
Yes.
When it will come out of its own anyway after a time, right? How have you standardized this 2 minute time? I'm like, has it been standardized
earlier by someone
or you only standardized
it? No,
standardized
earlier.
That is when standardized
video
earlier.
Yeah. Video play karna hoga.
Okay. Like, first, these are the video.
Yeah.
Second one.
So today we actually prepared a cup culture spontaneously. The people from Ismail Yusuf College have accompanied me in making the cup culture. So we took 2 cups and we poked holes into it on the base of the cup, and then we added tissue papers into it, and then we moistened it with water, with tap water. And then we went outside and collected the earthworms. We washed them into the in the water, and then we added them into those cup cultures. So this is a video of how we prepared the culture.
The voice is not clear.
Yeah.
Yes,
so this was from the soil. We were picking the earthworms and we were adding them into water to wash them, and then we added them into tissue cup culture. Today morning.
Okay, there is a feedback from Kochi Cube Group that everybody has to talk through microphone because they are not getting the questions because we are not using microphones.
So we made a video on how we do RER. So today our plan of work is to do RER. So this is the setup of our RER: distilled water, 200 millimolar NaCl solution, test tube stand with 2 test tubes. Make sure your test tubes are dry and wiped enough. So these are 3 beakers which consist of distilled water. Now let's start with the RER. Pipette out distilled water. Take 1 ml of distilled water. Make sure that the solution or distilled water doesn't attach
to the walls of the test tubes. Okay, so let's start with the RER. So remove earthworm from the cup cultures. Wash the earthworm in the first beaker which contains distilled water, because as it is kept in a cup culture, it contains fecal matter. Wipe the earthworm gently on the tissue paper so that the water doesn't remain on the earthworm and it doesn't change the dilution of the test tubes. Now put the earthworm very gently, make sure that it doesn't stick to the walls of the test tube. Now start the stopwatch and note the time. After 2 minutes, you can see that we got the expected result, as is expected that it should not come out of the distilled water. Now remove the earthworm gently from the test tubes. Again wash the earthworm in the distilled water beaker. Now add the earthworm into the 200 millimolar NaCl solution test tube gently. Start the stopwatch. You can now observe that the earthworm is coming out of the NaCl solution. Stop the stopwatch and note the timing in your logbook. Now remove the earthworm gently from the test tube. And wash it in the distilled water with the beaker 1. Wash it gently and carefully so that there will be no traces of salt solution. Now put it into the distilled water of beaker 2. Remove the earthworm gently from the beaker and wipe it on the tissue paper. Now put this earthworm into its respected cup culture.
So we did Arya SL.
What do you mean by Arya?
So basically Arya is a rapid SL response, and in this assay we took two test tubes. In one test tube we took 1 ml of distilled water, and in another test tube we took 1 ml of 200 millimolar NaCl solution. So in this assay
so what we do is we have our earthworms in our cup cultures. We make the earthworms out, we give them a wash of distilled water, we dab them on the tissue papers, and then we insert the earthworms.
One second, why are we being shown this same thing again? Why are you talking about this thing again when you have showed it so well earlier? Like everything was crystal clear. There's no need to talk about it again because it's a repetition. No? Same thing is being said again. No?
Yeah, the video is for the Movie Makers Club.
Okay.
Like it will be played on the last, but
That I didn't know.
Yeah.
But it's a very well made thing because it was absolutely clear. I was a bit concerned for the poor chap that, you know, so much of stress, water, salt, but then it survived all that and it gave you a nice response.
Yeah, we had to hear
that. Nicely done.
Yeah. So, can we, sir?
If it is not too long.
What?
If it is not too long, please carry on.
Okay.
The walls of the test.
So 2 minutes are ready for the earthworm, whether it comes out, to see whether it comes out or it does not. After 2 minutes, the earthworm is taken out. Again, dab on a tissue paper so that the excess water goes off. And the same earthworm is put into the test tube of NaCl with the help of brush.
Why are you using distilled water? What's your motto of using this distilled water?
Basically, we use distilled water for the control because earthworms don't have any harm towards the distilled water, but towards the NaCl, we think that
the earthworm gets irritated when it inserts the earthworm into NaCl. So if you use tap water instead of distilled water, then what would happen?
What I think, in tap water, there will be another minerals or acids or another impurities. So we use distilled water.
So in this area, the crucial thing is what do you expect? So do you have any expectations? Or you're just doing it?
No. We have our expectations. What we expect is, as we are giving 2 minutes, we do not expect to come out of the distilled water test tube even in 2 minutes. Whereas we expect the earthworm to come out of the NaCl solution before 2 minutes.
Do you have any design of your experiment? Please let us know. It's a very crucial point. Please, do you have?
Yes, we have design for the experiment. For the we going to give the lesions to the earthworm. For the control, we gonna give the lesion on the dorsal side. For the experimental side, we gonna give the lesion on the ventral side. And we have 4 earthworms for the control, which are unlesioned.
So, what do you expect after giving lesion? What do you expect after giving lesion? Please let us know.
For the ventral lesion side, we expect that the earthworm will not come out the NaCl solution
for the NaCl solution, for the lesion earthworm, the earthworm won't come out of the NaCl solution in 2 minutes, and distilled water it should not come out.
Why do you expect that earthworm won't come out of the NaCl solution? Why?
Because we
please draw an earthworm. Draw an earthworm. Do earthworms don't have any segments? Hey, come on, Manasvi. How a person coming from outside if this is an earthworm, or how a person will understand which part is an anterior, which part is a posterior. Please.
So this is the anterior part of the pulsar posterior. I'm just enlarging this first 10 seconds of the earthworm, so it will be something like this.
So is your earthworm open? So then show us the ventral cavity, how it works.
So I'm drawing the two ganglions, cerebral ganglions of the earthworm, which I extended.
See, why are you showing us this line? Why? Can you show us the connection of that line? Can we let us know how the earthworms work, how they coordinate?
So I just want to draw the signal.
So if we consider this to be the segments, the further connections are something according to what we think is like this.
What are you drawing that dot dot part? What do you mean by that?
It's like a two or three ganglion meetings, the nerve connections are meeting there.
What do you mean by ganglions?
Ganglions are just a cluster of cell bodies.
Can you please show us?
So what we expect is these are the ganglions, the segmental ganglions which are connected to the ventral nerve cord.
So are you sure the structure is like that? Harshika, please do search. Show them, is it right or not?
Like this.
So now what do you expect if the earthworm has given a lesion and it has put it or it has been exposed to NaCl solution? What do you expect?
So as then the lesion, we expect that the earthworm should not come out of the NaCl solution. Because the connection is not complete.
So see the first two segments, they cannot have a coordination. And see the last segments, four, five segments, they have coordination.
Yeah.
You have just disturbed the coordination between the two ganglions, but that doesn't, so that won't have a connection, but the remaining anterior part can move ahead. But the posterior part won't support him to come along slide of the test tubes. Okay, so now what do you expect?
Okay, so as you said, we give a lesion over here, so as we put this earthworm in the test tube of NaCl, so we expect that only this portion would start gliding up the walls of the test tube, but as the network is interrupted, this portion won't be coming out of the tube.
Okay, so fine, let's discuss this on the board and have some positive over there.
Okay. Here is a question from our Cube Australia. I don't know which Brisbane. I don't know which center this is. Subarna Ray is asking, with respect to your earlier comments, in nature, earthworm feeds on colloids, carbs, and proteins. Sorry. Are you supplying these components in your culture? Okay, in earthworm feeds on proteins and carbohydrates and lipids probably. And are you supplying these in your cup culture, I think? So I can't remember, I think, which center of Australia he is, Subarna Ray.
So
we
make tissue is a source of cellulose. That means it's a source of carbohydrates. And proteins we provide from normal tap water. So tap water contains bacteria. So that bacteria is fed by earthworm. So that means it's a protein.
It can be.
Protein is also
like,
getting as a source.
Yeah, but
tap water will not have that many amount of bacteria.
It should not have so
many bacteria. I know, but it should not.
Yeah, the main food is cellulose. The main food, the primary food. Yeah.
No, yeah. I was just saying that tap water has those many organisms because we have done an isolation and experiment on that.
We have done a water analysis.
Yeah, water analysis.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Earthworm with cellulose. So is this earthworm actually growing and living a life there? Then I mean I would expect that, you know, our regular textbook says that, you know, food usually consists of for every organism not just carbohydrates, but also proteins, fats, nucleic acids, vitamins, minerals. So do you have all of them in the cup culture?
Cellulose is a carbohydrate.
Right.
Bacteria is a protein.
Can be protein, yeah.
Protein source.
Where is the bacteria?
Bacteria is in the tap water.
In the tap water?
Yeah. So tap water will be consisting bacteria. So that bacteria will be fed by earthworm. So earthworm will have a protein source.
In little amount, not in the big.
And what about other things like minerals and all that?
Minerals.
Tap water will also have minerals.
So it has a full growth inside?
Like we never saw a cocoon or something like a baby coming from a cocoon in a cup culture.
Okay, so maybe we may have to do some kind of comparative cup cultures, you know, cup cultures that are more nourishing than just the tissue paper. Okay, for example, today morning when I was taking a walk, there are, you know, nowadays you have a lot of corrugated sheets spread on the road, like all those Amazon packings and all that. You know, I saw 2 days ago that pack was intact, but today that was completely degraded, you know, and a lot of castings I see on top of that whole thing. So there is a likelihood that, you know, instead of newspaper and tissue paper, maybe they like corrugated sheet much better. So you have to
check,
you know, think about all those other options. So I think that, you see, at least keeping the earthworm alive, I understand, but I don't see as of now whether that earthworm will actually grow, reproduce in the cup, because that would I call a proper life. You know, so that might also be important, because even regeneration requires a good nourishing environment, right? Because you are actually working on that kind of thing. So a little more experimentation is required, you know, work with different kinds of paper, different kinds of food sources, and you know, I think you have to work out various other ways in which how to keep the earthworm happy inside that cup. And I just want to inform you, all of you, that we have about 21 online users today, apart from the people who are sitting here, and about 17 of them are active right now.
Yeah.
So another 21 people are in this room right now, though they are not in body.
Okay, Subarna is from Queensland. He's writing.
Okay.
Thank you.
Hello, I have a question here. Do you provide water all the time? Matlab jab khatam ho jata hai water.
So we water the tray daily.
So does it grow? Means that size of the earthworm? Kabhi check kiya hai tum logo ne?
No.
We haven't checked.
We haven't checked that.
Shift 5. So now we have another model system for regeneration. This was Rishikesh and Manasvi from second year Elphinstone College. And we are calling, now Hydra has been worked out in many centers. So we have from Elphinstone College, we have from Chembunaka School, and we have from VS College. So from Elphinstone VS College, they are second year biotech students. And Arif is from Chembunaka School. Okay, a 10th standard student. So you can join. Yeah, sir.
So first of all, good afternoon, everyone. Hello, I am Devin. Hello. So first of all, good afternoon, everyone. I am Devin, and stop talking properly. Okay. I'm Devin, and these are my colleagues.
Myself Apurva Ghare.
And myself Krishna Kantaria.
Myself Snehal Laukudkar.
So we are currently studying at Elphinstone College, S5 Biotechnology. So our model is Hydra, and we are studying regeneration. So exactly what is Hydra? It's a freshwater organism which basically feeds on Moena and Daphnia, and in lab condition it feeds on Artemia, provided that Artemia is cultured by us in a different way. So what is regeneration now? So regeneration is a type of phenomena in which an organism develops or, you know, regrow its lost body part. So why we chose Hydra? We chose Hydra because it's far much easier to culture than other invertebrates. And the pattern which Hydra shows in regeneration is morphoaxis. Morphoaxis means means that if we ampute a Hydra into two different parts, we will get two small hydras, of which both of the small hydras will develop into a mature hydra or grow. So our immediate objective was culturing and maintaining hydra, which we are successful in doing. We started our hydra culture on 7th. We started with around 30 to 35 hydras, and till date we have 30 to 38 hydras, and today we have around 300 hydras. So our short-term objective is is to ampute and check its regenerative period, and our long-term objective is to study regeneration on genetic level, exactly which genes are responsible, which proteins are responsible in regeneration. So our hypothesis is from our observation that is, if we ampute a hydra, we expect that the hydra should recover its lost part within at least 2 days. Because mainly budding is observed within three days, and as I said, morphoaxis is morphoaxis is growing of the.
How do you say?
Sorry. We get complete two different hydras then it grows. So we expect that, if we ampute a hydra, the head part and the tail part. So the head part will generate the tail part simultaneously with the tail part regenerating the head part. And that's our hypothesis. So further on, design and protocol will be explained by Sneha.
Okay, so design. So we started culturing hydra on 7th July. So we kept 4 beakers, A, B, C, and D. So in A beaker, there was Hydra. In B, we kept Hydrilla. We were also having Hydrilla, which we brought from Cube. So in C, there was Hydra, and also in D. So after that, on 9 date, we saw that in beaker D, the Hydra was shrunk. So on 14th, we saw that in beaker A and C, the hydra were shrunk, and also that. So we transferred the hydra from A and C to beaker B. So on 15th, we saw that, we assumed that in beaker D, the hydra were dead. So we transferred this hydra in beaker E. Then after that, on 26th, Devin brought 4 hydras, and he cultured that hydra at his home. So we got a successful result, and today the count is 15. So the protocol. So we took beaker and the beaker was of 250 ml. So we add dechlorinated water up to 200 ml. So after that, we used dropper and we transferred Hydra into that beaker. And we feed the Hydra every day. Per Hydra, two moinas were fed. So after that, we placed a thin cloth on the beaker. And we change the water every day, or else alternate day.
So now, are you audible? Yeah. So now I would like to give a data about our Hydra growth. We started our culture on 7 July. The blue line is for beaker A, which had approx 15 Hydra. The orange line is for beaker B, which has approx 5 hydras. The green line was for beaker C, which had approx 10 hydras. And the yellow line was for beaker D, which has approx 8 to 9 hydras. So when we started these cultures on 7th, we saw a steady increase in their growth, in the number of hydras. But as Snehal mentioned, we used to change the DC water alternately. So on 12th, when we changed the DC water, we observed that the Hydra in beaker D started to shrunk, and even after feeding, they were not eating any moinas. This was the case of beaker D, which was seen on 12th July. On 13th, the next day, when we observed our beaker D, we saw that all the Hydras were shrunk, and we were just able to see some green blobs. So we assumed that they all were dead. Later on 14th, we changed the water on 12th, then we changed the water on 14th. On 14th, we saw that when we changed the water from A and C, we saw that the A and C beakers, Hydra from A and C also started showing the similar symptoms. So we did not want to lose them like we assumed that we lost our Hydra from D. So we transferred them into beaker B. That is why you can see a steep increase in the number of Hydra from 14th to 17th. Okay, so this was one of our goof ups which we did. Then on 17th, yeah. On 17th, surprisingly, we observed 3 Hydras in beaker D, and then we transferred them into a new beaker. Also, we also saw 2 more Hydras on 19th in the same beaker. So we are still trying to guess the cause of why they all were shrunk and why then we started observing 2. We still have the D beaker, and we still expect that some more Hydras we can get from that beaker without feeding. We have not fed the beaker from 12th was the last date. 12th July was the last date when we fed that beaker, and still we observed more Hydras on 16th that D beaker. Okay, so right now the condition of B beaker we have is approx 150 Hydras in beaker B. Okay, so now goof ups. As I mentioned earlier, on 13 July we assumed that the Hydra in beaker D shrunk and they turned into a pinpoint green blob. This is the blob which we can see, and here you can see that the tentacles have shrunk. You can also observe a moina, but this moina was not fed. It wasn't even attached to the tentacles, as we are not able to see any tentacles. Now on 14 July, as I mentioned earlier, the Hydra from A and C also shrunk. So this is a picture of its shrunking. We cannot observe tentacles even here. Yeah, and the third goof up that we did was we transferred the Hydra from beaker D to beaker E. Instead of feeding them in the same beaker. Okay. So now the current growth, the current status of our hydra cultures is, this is the blue one is the bee beaker. As you can see, we have 150 hydras. This orange one is the e beaker, which we made on 17 July from the hydra which we obtained from the D beaker. It was started on 17 July, and by far we have approx 40 hydras in it. Then this is the green line shows the about the F beaker. It was started on 19 July as the number of hydra was increasing in the another beaker, so we made some subcultures of in the beaker F. And E dash is the subculture of beaker E, so that as the number was increasing, we on 25th July, we observed that the hydra in beaker E were reached to approx 70 to 80 hydras, so we transferred them into another beaker E dash. Now the further will be explained by.
So these are the results and conclusion. As we mentioned the protocol, we achieved that our hydras were seen to be increased in each of the beaker, and even Devin, my colleague Devin, he took hydras, approx 4 hydras he took on, I guess, 26th. He took 4 hydras on 26th, and up till now he has 15 hydras by culturing at home. So that our immediate objective was achieved by the by approaching that protocol, and these are our further plans we need to carry out. As we are studying regeneration, our main objective is to study regeneration. We need to carry out amputation experiments, so we have a plan, as in we'll take the hydra. We have many hydras, so we'll take some of the hydras, we'll take it in a slide, and mostly when we study about hydra, we always study that it is cut into vertical section. Horizontal section, and then you will get two hydras. So we will take 6 hydras. We have well plates, so that would be convenient. Well, if we take 6 hydras, 3 of them will cut it into horizontal section, and so 3 of them will cut into vertical section, and we'll observe them by how many days they regenerate, about their lost body parts, and we have to study exact mechanism of regeneration in hydra, which is morphoaxis, which we need to study on genetic basis. We need to study which gene is responsible for regeneration in hydra, or what is exactly happening in morphoaxis. So that is our further plan, and these are the references we referred. So there is a book called Biology of Hydra by Alison Burnett, which was a great help for us, as it had what usually hydra feeds on, what is morphoaxis, we got it from there, and what is minimum tissue size regeneration.
The above reference is to show why do hydra regenerate and we don't? As I've studied that some of the genes are, you know, homology to us. Some of the hydra genes are homology to our genes. So this is a reference which explains why hydra regenerates its lost part and we don't.
Yeah, and since we are studying regeneration, we need to see that. Main question is, why are we studying regeneration in hydra? But it is convenient, it is not a complex organism. And usually we see that many accidents happen where people lose their body parts. If hydra can regenerate its lost body part, why can't human? So that is why we are studying on genetic basis. Yeah, that is, and we have a... and we have some of our colleagues from different school and college. They are also studying on regeneration of they are also culturing hydra. So I would like to request them, what are they doing exactly?
Excuse me, I have a question.
Yeah.
You have kept A, B, C, D beakers. So yeah. They were growing in B, but they were not growing in, they were not regenerating
okay,
in
other beakers.
So did you find out the reason why?
So thing is,
we think that the beaker bee is actually an ecosystem beaker which contains hydra, hydrilla, algae, and
okay.
of course moena. So we do not change the water of beaker bee. So we only used to change waters from beaker A, C, and D. So as on that particular date, what was that?
That's on
79. 70, no, that's on. So when we change the waters of these respective three beakers, that is A, B, A, C, and D, we observe that as we change the water, we observe that, you know, you getting that new water, they started to shrunk. So we thought that the fault must be in that water. So we are yet to find what exactly happened. Cause if we think that the fault is in water, why would we get, you know, that what do we say? Regeneration is not happening.
We will be starting regeneration.
And I just, for my curiosity, how have you started the hydra culture? I'm like the first 15 hydra that you started with?
Yeah.
35.
Okay.
Yeah.
So how did you obtain all those hydra?
We obtained these hydras from cube itself.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
You are the cube.
From
cube
lab. Okay.
Cube lab.
Sorry.
Okay, thank you.
Okay.
Like we aerate the surrounding of a particular hydra with a bubbler, so that with a dropper, so that, you know, the hydra detaches itself from the container, and then we suck it and then quickly transfer it to another beaker. Quickly, why? Because if we take time, the hydra can stuck to the walls of the dropper.
Okay.
He has
a question.
Over there.
Okay.
You mentioned that one of your colleagues took hydra at home and cultured it. So was there any difference that you used to culture it in the lab and someone who took it at home?
No, there wasn't any difference.
No difference. So actually the procedure was the same as
the same procedure.
In lab.
The same
How
procedure.
Can the condition be provided at home and lab be similar? Kind of. That's my question.
We provided similar conditions as in lab. We just maintain, we use beakers, we use DC water, and we use moenas. That's all we do in the lab. And the same conditions are provided at his home. He uses a glass jar, and he uses DC water, which is made at home, and the moenas to feed the hydra. That's all.
Okay, fine.
But I think you give a little more love at home. Okay, there is a question from Delhi. Chitra from Delhi, Dyal Singh College, Delhi. So she is asking, why no increase in number of hydra in the first week? Did you say that? In the first week, you didn't have much increase in number. So
we had a steady increase in the number.
I see.
Okay. Yeah.
Can you just go back to that slide?
We need to connect this.
And can we focus on this slide? Sorry. Can we focus on this slide, the technical people? Because they are not able to see the slides they are writing. Ashish, can we focus on this slide?
when the slide comes.
अरे ये लटक गया ये लैपटॉप चल रहा है देख देख इधर देख
आ स्टार वॉर्स
मिरर यहाँ पे इसका एक्टिविटी सेटिंग अरे लैपटॉप कनेक्ट नहीं हो रहा प्रोजेक्टर से अभी हाँ देखो कनेक्ट हो गया पर वो मेन फंक्शन नहीं डाल रहा
ओके ओके यू कैरी ऑन विद द अदर थिंग्स आई थिंक वंस वंस यू सॉर्ट इट आउट यू कैन डू दैट अदरवाइज कैरी ऑन
वीडियो भी दिखाना सर
व्हाट इज दिस
ऑडियो इज एन उस्ताद एक्चुअली ही हैज बीन डूइंग फॉर द लास्ट 3 इयर्स सो मेनी थिंग्स ही हैज डन सो मेनी
नहीं आ रहा है
एक्चुअली द मोइना स्टफ
अभी कनेक्ट नहीं हो रहा
रिसोर्सेज पे जाओ
ये जो ये है गाइस ये क्या
हां इस पे क्लिक किया और क्लिक करो
ये तो इसका दिखाएगा डेस्कटॉप पे जाना पड़ेगा इसको ये डिटैच किया ना तो ऐसा हो गया गाइस
ऐसा सेम की एक वन
ओके तू इस किसका निकाल दे बाद में
तू इधर ज्वाइन कर ले
नहीं हो रहा अभी वो एक मिनट किसी का था
उसका सेटिंग किधर है मिरर इमेज दिखता है ना मिरर
सो इधर डेस्कटॉप पे जाके स्क्रीन पे
उधर जाके करना होगा यार तुम नहीं समझ रहे हो उधर दिखना चाहिए
ओके
एक सेकंड लेट्स लुक एट दिस इधर
कैन बी वन ऑफ यू जस्ट लुक आफ्टर दैट ओके
स्क्रीन व्हाट डू वांट किस में जाना है मिरर किस में आता है मिरर आता है ना
डिस्प्ले के स्क्रीन रेजोल्यूशन में आता है
स्क्रीन रेजोल्यूशन
वी आर स्टक
मिरर किधर आएगा किधर है मिरर
व्हाट हैपेंड
हां ये अरे वो लैपटॉप में दिख रहा है
सीधा वहां पे जाना नीचे जाना नीचे टैब्स खोले उधर
45
सर नीचे टैब्स खोले ना सीधा उधर क्लिक करो ना नीचे नीचे हां अभी पीपीटी ऐसे पर
ओ एनीवे टू कंपेयर द पीपल टू गो अहेड नो
ये हुआ तो ओपन ही कर रहा हूं किधर है इसमें है इसमें है क्या इसमें है किधर ओपन हो रहा है बता मैं तुझे पता है लास्ट में हमने किया था उधर से सेटिंग में करना होता है मिरर इमेज करना होता है यहाँ पे मिरर इमेज है किधर मिरर इमेज अरे यार डिस्प्ले में जाना सेटिंग में वो उबंटू पे बताया ये विंडोज़ है एक्चुअली नहीं आ रहा
विंडोज़
पर्सनल जा हाँ अभी नहीं जा डेस्कटॉप का ग्राम नहीं यार
या आशीष विल कम
आशीष होता नहीं मिरर आता ना मिरर करना होता
है ना वो काम से नहीं आ रहा
है क्या
चेक कैसे करते
हो यहाँ से नहीं वहाँ ही दिखेगा
ये तुमने स्क्रीन टू में डाल रखा है
इधर हो रहा उधर नहीं हो रहा मिरर
तुमने स्क्रीन टू में डाल दिया वो स्क्रीन टू गया कहाँ फुटिंग कहाँ वाली
मिरर ना
हाँ कहाँ से आया था वो
एक सेकंड
वहाँ देखो ऑप्शन करते हैं तुमने क्या चीज़ कैसे किया
हटाने
दूसरा कुछ ओपन हो रहा है
कुछ नहीं ये एक्चुअली स्क्रीन वन पे आ रहा है। वो सिस्टम हटा दो, सिस्टम कौन सा था
बस कनेक्ट कर
दिया गया। ठीक है ठीक है।
Okay, there is a question from Pondicherry, Abhishek. What do we know about the mechanism of regeneration in Hydra from literature? Okay. Anybody is going to take that? Literature means what background information we have from earlier work, published work. I think you showed some references, is it? Anyway, can you just tell something offhand? This is Abhishek from Pondicherry, Q Pondicherry.
So,
yeah, carry on. You have the mic, okay. Is it?
Okay, back.
So, as we mentioned, biology of Hydra, we read that Hydra has endoderm, ectoderm, and in between it has mesoglia. So that mesoglia, it has unspecialized interstitial cells which are stem cells, and if we ampute it, it will regenerate. So this was the reference. I mean, this was written in that published work, I guess. Yeah.
You said about some author. You gave some author's name.
Alison Burnett.
From which university or lab?
That University of Geneva, right?
Okay, so the point is that, like earlier we were discussing about it, when you are giving a reference, it will be nice that you refer to an author and the affiliated institution, the year of publication.
Okay.
If it's a publication that you are referring to 1905, that's different from you are referring to something 2005, is it not?
Yeah.
Okay.
I have a question. Yeah.
Yeah. Sure.
So, how are you going to check for regeneration? Means, how much growth has been occurred? Uh-huh. Like, the earthworm group is doing RER, that is a rapid escape response, to confirm that regeneration is occurring. But in your organism, after lesion, how are you going to check that it has regenerated?
We'll be taking pictures like at every specific interval of time. So, from that exact focal length and that. That's
but
a different thing.
What is the size of your organism? Like,
max is 3 cm.
Yeah. So after cutting, it will be like 1.5 or something.
Yeah.
So how are you going to check? Like, it has regenerated. It will be a very minute growth, right?
Yeah. We have a macro lens for that.
Okay.
We have micro lens, and the videos which we'll be showing.
Showing, yeah.
It is shooted from micro lens, so you'll be able to see it clearly. So that.
So
will
be will the regrowing cells appear differently or?
That we are yet to study.
Yeah.
Can you do something like staining them or something so
yeah,
that
yeah, 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 sure.
You can find
yeah,
yeah.
But by staining them, you can see it might be that it will affect Hydra.
You can
it
find
can
some
stains. It can affect Hydra.
There.
I don't know, but it any sense it can affect Hydra. So.
So you can check for that. Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, please ask questions if when they are.
So,
okay.
So again the same thing. I'm asking you that how will you measure the regeneration? Like we give amputation. If we amputate our earthworm, so how we measure is we first
by segments.
The segments.
Yeah.
So you should also have some marker to understand. Okay, there's a regeneration going on, and these are the things. You cannot depend. Okay, you can have a photos, but how will you write it in your logbook? You can't stick the photos. So you'll have to have a measure or something.
Yeah. So that's what I told, that we'll be taking pictures from a specific specific focal length every day and at the same time. So that pixel density, that there's an app which I don't know exactly, there's an app which lets you compare two exact frame which has the exact frame photos, so that will tell you what is the difference between the two photos. So we'll be encountering the amount of growth which is seen in the next day by that technique. So here's a video which is shot on a smartphone using a macro lens which has 20x zoom. So here you can see that Hydra engulfing Moina.
As you can see that the tentacles are moving to push Moina inside. See this, these tentacles.
So now we can see that the Hydra has engulfed the Moina completely.
See here we can observe that the mouth has also closed. Can you observe the tentacles being near to each other? And the eye and Moina is completely engulfed here.
Sorry? Okay.
Yeah.
We have another video which shows how Hydra catches Moina. Too fast, but
we shot it in time lapse, so it's a bit fast.
Sorry about the shaky video. Here you can see that the mouth has opened up a bit to engulf the Moina. The tentacles helps in pushing the Moina into the system.
Now we have another video in which one Moina is being caught by two other Moinas, two other Hydras. So you can see the right Hydra has already started engulfing the Moina. Sorry. and now they have been separated.
Okay, there's a question from Shreyas.
तो मेरा नाम आरिफ सैग है, तो मैं चैम्बूर नाका मुंबई पब्लिक स्कूल द बीएमसी स्कूल. सो मैं यहाँ पे 2 साल से काम कर रहा हूँ यहाँ पे, मतलब हायर. पहले स्टार्टिंग में तो यहाँ पे देख लीजिए ये मोइना का स्लाइड है, तो स्टार्टिंग मैंने यहाँ से मोइना से किया, तो फिर मोइना अपना कल्चर एंड मेंटेनेंस. तो यहाँ पे फिर क्या हुआ, ये लैब में हमारे फिर हाइड्रा है, तो इसमें जैसे कि पहले ग्रुप ने हाइड्रा प्रेजेंट किया, तो पहले हाइड्रा आया, तो यहाँ पे ये हाइड्रा जो है हम लोग ने पुणे से लेके आया था. ये पुणे से लेके आने के बाद इसको हम लोगों ने मेंटेनेंस कैसे करना है, तो हम लोग ने जहाँ से हाइड्रा लिया वहाँ से उसका मेंटेनेंस सोर्स क्या है, हम लोग ने वहाँ से वो कैरी किया, तो फिर हम लोग यहाँ पे लैब में लेके आके मेंटेन कर रहे थे. और वो जो हाइड्रा अभी बढ़िया गया, सो जो हाइड्रा है ये मेंटेन आर्टिमिया पे कर रहे थे. तो इससे पहले जो हाइड्रा आर्टिमिया पे मीना मैम है यहाँ पे लास्ट में पीछे बैठे हैं, तो वो हाइड्रा को आर्टिमिया से मेंटेन कर रहे थे. तो फिर देख सकते हैं ये जो सेटअप पहला ये जो दिख रहा है ये आर्टिमिया का सेटअप. तो इसमें क्या लैंप और ये यहाँ पे जो बीकर दिख रहा है, यहाँ पे देख रहे हो ये आर्टिमिया कल्चर के रिक्वायरमेंट क्या है, बीकर, डिस्टिल वाटर, रॉक सॉल्ट और आर्टिमिया सिस्ट. फिर इसको वेट बैलेंस करने के बाद फिर हम लोग इसको जो यहाँ पे बीकर दिख रहा है इसमें हम लोग आर्टिमिया पहले लिया हम लोगों ने डीसी वाटर, उसमें प्लस सॉल्ट, फिर आर्टिमिया का सिस्ट मींस एग लिया उसमें, और फिर उसको हम लोगों ने एयर ऑक्सीजन सप्लाई किया जिससे वो हैच हो जाए. तो ऐसे हम लोग को मतलब ये जो है ये आर्टिमिया सेटअप ये बहुत अगर हम लोग देखें इसे तो ये डिफ़िकल्ट हम लोग को लग रहा था. इसके सॉल्ट अगर जो स्टार्टिंग में ये सेकेंड ग्रुप ने जो फर्स्ट ग्रुप ने बोला कि ये हाइड्रा जो फ्रेश वाटर ऑर्गेनिज्म है और जो ये आर्टिमिया है ये सॉल्ट वाटर ऑर्गेनिज्म है. अब फ्रेश वाटर ऑर्गेनिज्म को सॉल्ट वाटर ऑर्गेनिज्म तो हम लोग को फीड नहीं करना चाहिए क्योंकि वो अच्छा प्रोसेस नहीं है. तो हम लोग ने यहाँ पे क्या देखा कि मतलब फिर हम लोग को जो फीड जो हम लोग को आर्टिमिया फीडिंग करना होता था, तो हम लोग ये जो आर्टिमिया लेते थे फर्स्ट हम लोग इसको वॉश करके फिर हम लोग हाइड्रा फीड करना होता था. तो ये सब डिफ़िकल्टी हम लोग को फेस हुआ इसके. फिर हम लोग ने आगे क्या ट्राई किया कि फिर हमने क्या ट्राई किया, जो हम लोगों ने दोनों ऑर्गेनिज्म को देखा कि आर्टिमिया और मोइना, जैसे कि आप देखिए फर्स्ट ग्रुप ने मोइना से फीडिंग करके आर्टिमिया कल्चर कर रहे. तो हम लोगों ने स्टार्टिंग में क्या किया, हमने पहले हमारे पास था आर्टिमिया तो हम आर्टिमिया से फीड कर रहे थे, तो हम लोगों ने आर्टिमिया को भी देखा और मोइना को भी देखा, दोनों क्रस्टेशियन फैमिली के थे. तो हम लोगों ने क्या किया उसको दोनों को माइक्रोस्कोप पे ऑब्जर्व किया, दोनों सिमिलर दिख रहे थे. तो
तो हमने क्या किया, जो मोइना एक एक वेल प्लेट्स में मोइना और हाइड्रा लिया, तो हमने क्या देखा, जो मोइना है वो हाइड्रा खा रहा था, तो हम लोग इससे मालूम पड़ा कि हम लोग हाइड्रा भी मोइना को हाइड्रा हम लोग फीड कर सकते, हाइड्रा को मोइना हम लोग फीड कर सकते हैं। तो इससे हम लोग ने एक नया सिस्टम फिर निकाला। तो हम लोग के अगर देखे पहला का देख रहे हो आप लोग, आर्टेमिया के लिए हम लोग को लैम्प, वाटर, सॉल्ट, वो सब रिक्वायरमेंट में हम लोग को चाहिए। यहाँ पे अगर देखें हाइड्रा मोइना सेटअप, तो यहाँ पे मोइना सेटअप के लिए हम लोग को सिर्फ ये बॉटल्स चाहिए, टू बॉटल्स और हम यहाँ पे देखें हाइड्रा जो फीड हम लोग ने किया। तो यहाँ पे जैसे मोइना इंग्लो ने फर्स्ट ग्रुप ने उसे बताया कि मोइना फीड करना है, तो मोइना फीड करने से पहले हम लोग उसको कल्चर कर रहना चाहिए। मोइना का कल्चर हम लोग कर पाए तो हम लोग को हाइड्रा कल्चर करके हम लोग हाइड्रा फिर उसको हम लोग जो रिसर्च रीजनरेशन एक्सेट्रा जो रिसर्च है हम लोग कर सकते हैं। तो आप मोइना मेंटेनेंस, हाउ टू कल्चर मोइना, तो फर्स्ट रिक्वायरमेंट ट्रांसपेरेंट बॉटल, डीसी वाटर, ड्रॉपर, मोइना, मिल्क, कॉटन और लॉग बुक। पहले इसमें जो बॉटल है इसमें हम लोग को डीसी वाटर 250 ml डीसी वाटर में जो डीक्लोरिनेटेड वाटर है, जो बीएमसी ऐसे कि आप लोगों ने पहले बोला था कि अर्थोम और कुछ इधर रिलेट किया था कि हम लोग टैप वाटर डायरेक्ट फीड कर रहे हैं तो उसमें बैक्टीरिया हो सकता है कि नहीं हो सकता है, तो टैप वाटर में क्या बैक्टीरिया नहीं रहेगा, बिकॉज बीएमसी हम लोग जो टैप वाटर देती है उसमें हम लोग क्लोरिन प्रोवाइड करती है कि कोई हार्मफुल ऑर्गेनिज्म उसमें प्रोड्यूस ना हो और वो हम लोग को इफेक्ट ना करें। तो हम लोग ने यहाँ पे क्या किया, बकेट में वाटर लिया है, यहाँ पे हम लोग